Well, good evening, and welcome to the second event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, Director of the Hall Centre, which administers the series. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you Diane Ravitch, former Assistant Secretary of Education, without rival as an historian of modern American schooling, and a public commentator of intellectual honesty and open-mindedness. Professor Ravitch will take questions after her talk, if you would make your way to one of the two microphones. Afterwards, in the room opposite this auditorium, there will be a reception for our guest speaker, who will also do a book signing. Everybody is welcome. A reminder, it's in your program, but tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, Professor Ravitch will lead a conversation about school reform. This will take place in the Hall Center Conference Hall. These are always, in my view, very enjoyable conversations. I do encourage you to attend. Tonight's event is supported by the Sosland Foundation of Kansas City. I'm deeply grateful to Morton and Estelle Sosland for their long, continued, and munificent support of the lecture series. They are with us in the audience this evening, and we should thank them for their generosity. To introduce Diane Ravitch, I've asked Rudd Turnbull, the Ross and Mariana Beach Distinguished Professor in Special Education and Lifespan Studies. He's also director of the Beach Center on Disability. Professor Turnbull has an LLB from the University of Maryland and an LLM from Harvard Law School. He's a renowned scholar of special education with a large number of journal articles, book chapters, and books to his name. His most recent book, now in its sixth edition, is Exceptional Lives, Special Education in Today's Schools. An earlier book, now in its fifth edition, is Law and the Education of Children with Disabilities. He has garnered many large grants for his research from the Department of Education and received many awards and honors for his work. It gives me great pleasure to say, please welcome Professor Rudd Turnbull.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Victor Bailey and the Hall Center faculty and staff, and indeed on behalf of the entire University of Kansas community, Dr. Ravitch, we are happy to have you here this evening. My job is to introduce you briefly to the audience. Briefly is a tough word when you look at her CV. Let me introduce you first by detailing, in brief, your impressive qualifications, and then by characterizing the significance of your work. Dr. Ravitch is the research professor of education at New York University. She's also a non-resident scholar of the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. As an historian of education in the United States, she's the author of 10 books, count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 books, and she's the editor of 14 other books. She has written 500 articles in peer-reviewed and in popular journals. She has lectured in 10 different countries, and she has had her work translated into 11 different languages. Not unsurprisingly, she's a member of the National Academy of Education, the Society of American Historians, and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. She has received honors and awards from, among others, the National Phi Beta Kappa Society, the American Philosophical Society, the Library of Congress, the United Federation of Teachers, the National Education Association, Teachers College of Columbia University of the City of New York, and the American Academy of Political Science. That's her academic side. As a national leader in education policy, she has held the office of Assistant Secretary of Education in the United States Department of Education and she was counselor to Secretary of Education Lamar Alexander during the presidency of George Herbert Walker Bush. There, she was responsible for the Office of Educational Research and Improvement, and in that effort, she led the department in the creation of voluntary state and national academic standards. During the presidency of William Jefferson Clinton, Secretary of Education Riley twice appointed her to be a member of the National Assessment Governing Board, and this entity oversees the federal testing program. She graduated from the Houston, Texas Public Schools, Wellesley College, and with her PhD from Columbia University's Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. Her honorary degrees are from such distinguished universities and colleges as Williams, Reed, Amherst, Middlebury, and Union, and the State University of New York, among others. Now, having described her impressive qualifications, please let me say a word or two about the significance of her work and characterize it for you, perhaps in anticipation of her remarks. As if still a child, she writes that she still remembers and she honors a model public school teacher. This was a teacher who brooked no sloth and no sloppiness in academics or in demeanor. As an historian, she studies and seeks to understand the past and its import for the present and the future. In that same mode, she accumulates and she has dispassionately analyzed evidence. She has never been fearful of changing her conclusions, even, indeed, especially, the conclusions she has reached in her distinguished career in our federal government. And as a citizen and a public servant, she asserts that education should be distributed equally to people in every neighborhood, and that our public school education system is a fundamental element of our democratic society. Dr. Ravitch's voice is the voice of bravery in the face of fads and of common sense in an enterprise that is sometimes too often driven by inapposite ideology. Dr. Ravitch, welcome to the University of Kansas.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. I want to thank the Sosslins and thank the whole Center for the Humanities for inviting me here this evening to KU. I was advised, please do not say UK. Do I have any of my Twitter friends here? Yeah, hi. We've been tweeting recently about the fact that I'm here tonight. Any teachers in the audience? Yay, thank you. Give yourselves a round of applause. Thank you very much. You don't get enough thanks. Well, I'm here tonight to talk about the crisis in American education. There is a crisis. But it's not the one you've read about. It's not the one you see on television. It's not a crisis of low test scores and bad teachers. The real crisis is caused by bad federal education policies. The real crisis is caused by mean-spirited, senseless attacks on dedicated teachers and principals. The real crisis is caused by a massive disinvestment in education. The real crisis is caused by billionaires who want to privatize our public schools. The real crisis is caused by governors and legislatures who are lowering standards for entry into education and who are slashing their budgets for essential services. The real crisis is caused by entrepreneurs who look at the public schools and see not a vital public resource, but a business opportunity. Well, I stand before you tonight as a chastened and repentant reformer, an ex-reformer. I now call myself an improver, not a reformer. Last year, I published a book, which just came out this week in paperback. I think you'll see it outside. And I added a new last chapter, summing up the last 2 years. But last year, this book came out in which I explained why I changed my mind about testing, accountability, and choice And I did something you don't hear too often these days. I said that I was wrong. Some people found it refreshing to hear an admission of error, and others thought I had disgraced myself because I changed my mind. Of course, it meant that I changed my mind from where they were. The people whose forces I joined with thought it was really great. I believe the best thing we can do for ourselves and for our society is to keep thinking, to keep listening to different points of view, and to be open to new ideas. That's what education is all about, the willingness to listen and to learn and to admit error. Tonight I'm going to explain why I changed my mind about these issues, and my explanation starts with understanding the frame through which we view the world. We live our lives by the stories that we tell ourselves. We construct narratives to explain events, and we make sense of the world through those narratives. Today we have a national school reform narrative based on the stories of what I call the bad news industry. I know this industry well because I used to be part of it. I, too, was one of those people who scrutinized every set of test scores, every indicator, and every new study to show how terrible our schools were. And I was part of that large chorus who warned every day that the sky was falling. It's been falling since 1983, when we learned that the nation was at risk because of what was then called a rising tide of mediocrity. The bad news chorus is louder than ever today, and bigger than ever today. It's very loud, very powerful, but I'm going to argue tonight that they're wrong, and I'm going to explain why I don't sing their song anymore. The bad news industry is no longer on the outside looking in. In fact, it's in control, and its leaders are those who call themselves reformers. Their story is wrecking public education. American public education has always had critics, but the critics wanted to make the public schools better. They didn't want to privatize them. Never before in our history has there been such a powerful, well-funded, well-coordinated movement determined to dismantle public education. These reformers, so-called, believe that a coordinated strategy of testing, accountability, and choice is the very best way to fix the schools. Now, I prefer to call these people corporate reformers because they want the schools to operate along the lines of the free market. They want parents to become consumers making choices, children to be products shaped by the demands of the schools, and test scores become the profits and losses that determine the condition of the business. Teachers are supposed to be employees who have no rights, no seniority, and they get a bonus if they get higher scores, they get fired if they have low scores, or they may be fired for any reason at all because they will be at-will employees. The corporate reformers want to transform public education as we've known it. They want to change it from a community institution with doors open to all, serving democratic purposes, into a privately managed, deregulated private sector activity funded with government dollars. The corporate reformers believe in their story. They believe it's such a perfect remedy that they will not listen to anyone who disagrees with them, and they refuse to consider evidence, rather powerful evidence, I believe, that their story may in fact be wrong. The more their story fails, the more it's discredited by research and experience, the more determined they become to press forward with the reforms. Well, after I had served in the first Bush administration, I was an active participant in two very prominent conservative think tanks. And for a decade, I supported the free market reforms. But as these ideas went from theory to practice, I began to realize that these strategies were not working, that the claims made for testing accountability and choice were not, in fact, panning out, that the evidence was weak and with each new report was getting weaker. And I stopped believing. I got off the train as it left the station. That train, it now turns out, has become bipartisan. It has the support of our biggest billionaire philanthropist, including the Gates Foundation, the Eli Broad Foundation of Los Angeles, the Walton Family Foundation of Arkansas, and many, many others. The movement consists of a very wealthy and powerful alliance of both Republicans and Democrats, and Wall Street hedge fund managers. The Wall Street hedge fund managers are clustered around a group called Democrats for Education Reform. There is no group called Republicans for Education Reform because they already believe in these strategies of testing accountability and choice. Democrats for Education Reform supplies millions of dollars for local, state, and national election campaigns, which gives them immense influence with Democratic politicians. DEFR, as it's known, Democrats for Education Reform, does not need to give money to Republican politicians because they already have the agenda. The Gates Foundation grants tens of millions of dollars every year, close to $100 million a year now, to advocacy groups such as think tanks and other nonprofits, which not surprisingly advance the views of the Gates Foundation. In some states, there are independent billionaires like the Koch brothers, the Walton family, and many others whose names would not be known to you, and they're funding politicians, both Democrats and Republicans, to advance privatization policies. Last week, I was at Duke University and was told about billionaires who are funding these policies in that state. I then went to give a lecture at Furman University in South Carolina. Same story, different set of billionaires. What this alliance supports, clearly, is testing and accountability, choice, charters, and very often vouchers. Many of them are anti-union and want to remove all job protections from teachers. They'll tell you that our schools spend too much. They'll recite all the dismal statistics about international test scores, and they'll say that our schools are failing poor kids, they're failing middle-class kids, they're also failing gifted kids. There doesn't seem to be anyone they're not failing. Well, most of the reform leaders, as it turns out, went to elite private schools, and they don't know very much about public education. But they do seem to know what to do to fix it. They believe so passionately in testing that they want teachers to be judged by their students' test scores. Of course, that's not what happens in private schools for the children of the wealthy, but they never mention that. They want schools of education to be judged by the test scores of the students taught by the graduates of the education schools. It's a far reach and many links in that chain, but the U.S. Department of Education just recommended that this is the way to improve teacher education, to measure in that fashion. The corporate reformers don't know anything about sociology or child psychology or cognitive development, but they can cite all of the conservative economists from places like the Hoover Institution, where I was affiliated for 10 years. And these conservative economists say the only thing that matters is performance. Their definition of performance is test scores. The corporate reformers never heard of the economists who don't agree with those conclusions. They trust only the economists who assure them that teachers don't need master's degrees, don't need small classes, and don't need experience. All they need to be considered a great teacher is to produce higher test scores year after year. The corporate reformers believe that the teacher is solely responsible for whether the scores go up or down. They don't care about class size. They believe that we'll reach world-class achievement by closing low-performing schools, firing teachers, firing principals, and ruthlessly weeding out those teachers who fail to produce higher scores. They never explain how an annual firing ritual will affect workplace morale, or where we will find a steady stream of great new teachers to replace the 5 to 10% that they think should be fired every year. Well, this narrative, I believe, is a false narrative. It has no evidence to support it, just ideology. Its remedies are a threat to the future of the teaching profession as well as to public education. The free market works very well in providing goods and services for the private sector, but it's not the right way to operate basic public services. The free market has many virtues, but it does not produce equality. It produces winners and losers. As we learned in the fall of 2008, when the market collapsed, as we continue to learn again and again, the free market experiences cycles, and it experiences major downturns in which there are very few winners and quite a lot of losers. And the free market, frankly, is not kind to losers. But the goal of our schools is to raise up every child, not to pick winners and losers. We're supposed to treat every single child as a unique and precious individual. We do this not to win a global competition, not to be economically competitive, but because we would like to be, or should like to be, a decent society where everyone has an equal chance to reach his or her full potential. Education is not a competition. Education is not a race. It's a long and slow incremental process of development. There is no finish line, until you die. Education should prepare each of us to make our way in the world and to do the best we can. The ideas of the corporate reform movement come mainly from non-educators, especially from leaders in the high-tech sector and these hedge fund managers. They believe in creative disruption and innovation. They love the idea of tearing things up and starting over. They enjoy risk. It works. It works for them. They can place a bet, they can have a new idea, and they can strike it rich overnight. But disruption and chaos are not good for children. Children need stability. They don't need disruption. They don't need chaos. They don't need risk. They need caring adults who are there for them every day, year in and year out, as a steady and reliable presence. Good public education should be a basic human right and a fundamental public service, not a consumer good whose availability is determined by market forces. Not so long ago, the two major political parties had a serious difference of opinion about education policy. Democrats believed in equality of educational opportunity, in resources for the disadvantaged, in strengthening the teaching profession, and Republicans believed in accountability, competition, and choice. That argument is over. It's been over since the passage of No Child Left Behind a decade ago. In the current climate, both parties believe in accountability, competition, and choice. The Republicans won that one, and hardly any voices on the national scene are arguing for equity, desegregation, resources targeted to the neediest, and improving the standards of the teaching profession. No Child Left Behind, our major federal education legislation, marked a major sea change in the education policy in our history. For anyone with eyes to see, No Child Left Behind has turned out to be the worst federal education legislation ever passed by Congress. No Child Left Behind, or NCLB, is a failed federal policy that's ruining education. The pressure to raise test scores every year has promoted cheating, gaming the system, teaching to the test, and narrowing the curriculum. Because of NCLB, many schools and districts have had to cut back on the arts, on physical education, history, civics, foreign languages, and other subjects because they don't count. Only reading and math counts. Many schools have eliminated libraries, librarians, guidance counselors, social workers, and other services because they've had to direct their limited funding into testing and test-taking materials. After all, the test scores will determine whether the school lives or dies, and they matter most. We can now see that NCLB federalized control of public education. The most significant decisions about what happens in the public schools are now made in Washington, not in state capitals and local school districts. Washington puts up 10% of the money, but Washington holds the reins of power. NCLB mandates that all children in grades 3 through 8 must be proficient in reading and math by 2014. Sounded good in 2001, but it's an impossible goal. It's one that has never been met by any nation in the world, and it will not be met by any state in this country. Last spring, Secretary Duncan said that more than 80% of the schools would be labeled failing schools this year. By 2014, if the law has not been changed, virtually 100% of our schools will be failing schools. Now I ask you, can you think of any national legislative body in the world that has ever passed a law that was guaranteed to stigmatize every public school in the nation? This is literally insane, certainly irresponsible. But now Secretary Duncan has offered waivers to states that want to escape NCLB's timetable of destruction. But those that apply for waivers, and most states are applying for waivers, have to agree to accept his mandates instead of NCLB's. And in some ways, they're not much better. NCLB was based on a campaign slogan of George W. Bush, in which he claimed that there had been a miracle in Texas. Well, as I said at the outset, we live our lives by the stories we tell. This one was a whopper. The theory was this: if you test everyone, if you post the scores, if you reward the schools that get test score gains and embarrass those that do not, then good things happen. Graduation rates go up, test scores go up, and the achievement gap narrows. The only problem was that none of it was true. It didn't happen in Texas. There was no Texas miracle. But Congress bought the idea by overwhelming majorities and passed this terrible law. So the philosophy of the law I define in three words: measure and punish. When a school can't meet the impossible targets of NCLB, the sanctions get progressively worse every year, with the ultimate sanction being to fire the principal, fire half the staff or all the staff, close the school, convert it to a charter, turn it over to the state, turn it over to private management. There is little or nothing in the law to support or encourage educators. There is nothing to inspire. What there is fear, intimidation, humiliation, sanctions, and punishments, ending in firing and closure. Of course, Congress shouldn't tinker with No Child Left Behind. It should repeal it. It should be replaced by a federal policy that supports equity and equitable resources for the students who need the most and promotes a sound education for all. Congress should not tell districts or schools how to reform, because Congress is not competent to do it. I watch every day the stories about the legislation being shaped now about how Congress wants to evaluate teachers, how they want to change this and change that, and I think they don't know what they're doing. It's frightening to see these men and women shaping law that will affect the lives of students and schools, having no knowledge of the implications, as they did not 10 years ago. Congress should endorse policies to help schools that enroll large numbers of low-performing students, not the current policies that use test scores to punish schools. Many of the schools that are called failing schools are schools that have disproportionately large numbers of low-performing students who are low-performing because they're poor, because they don't speak English, because many of them have disabilities. In some places, like the city where I live, schools are targeted to be closed by overloading them with disproportionate numbers of low-performing students, and then they're labeled failing and closed. Well, the corporate reformers do love testing and accountability for other people's children, but they would not want their own children in a school that had no arts, no time for play, and that spent weeks preparing for tests of basic skills. I got a tweet the other day from a superintendent in upstate New York, and he said he has told his staff that they're to devote a solid week without testing or test prep. And I said, why don't you try a month? See where it takes you. Bill Gates told the nation's governors last spring that children should have larger classes, but he wouldn't want that for his children. Bill Gates and Arne Duncan both said that districts should not pay teachers more for master's degrees or experience, and because that's what the conservative economists have told them. But I would like to understand the logic of this. How will our schools improve if teachers have less education, less experience, and larger classes? It doesn't make any sense. Well, Race to the Top is no improvement over No Child Left Behind. It, too, promotes privatization. It requires states to open more privately managed charter schools, to establish merit pay programs, to evaluate teachers by student test scores, and to agree to transform low-performing schools. Now, transformation sounds like a really good idea. We all like the idea of being transformed. I would like to be transformed myself. But it turns out that the options for transformation are no different from the sanctions of No Child Left Behind. Transformation means this. It means that part or all of the staff will be fired, or that the school might be turned into a charter school, or closed and replaced. Behind all of these strategies is the same tired old formula of testing, accountability, and choice, which is now getting a bit long in the tooth. Well, Arne Duncan applied all these same supposedly transformative policies when he was superintendent of schools in Chicago. And every evaluation of his program, which he called Renaissance 2010, has concluded that it made very little difference. I was in Chicago in the spring of 2010, and again earlier this year, and I asked audiences, it's 2010, I said, or 2011, have you had a renaissance yet? No one knew of any renaissance in Chicago. Scores of schools have been closed, scores of schools have been opened. Few of the new ones are better than the old ones. Most of the children who transferred from an old low-performing school to a new school transferred to a new low-performing school. And the latest evaluation shows that the achievement gap widened because African-American students fell even further behind. In New York City, we're now closing new schools that were open to replace old schools. It's a game of musical chairs. In response to No Child Left Behind and Race to the Top, public schools across the nation are beginning to close. Some of them have closed because their scores were too low. As schools close their doors, communities are destabilized and fragmented. Sometimes the new schools succeed in urban districts because they exclude low-performing students. That works every time. Gets the scores up when you keep out the low-performing kids. But closing schools doesn't help immigrant students read English, and it doesn't narrow the achievement gap. Closing schools does nothing to address the educational needs of students. Public schools are not chain stores that can be closed and opened at will. They should be vital community institutions, not transient agencies that come and go as test scores rise or fall. In one sense, Race to the Top is even worse than No Child Left Behind. No Child Left Behind holds schools accountable. Race to the Top holds teachers accountable. Its demand to judge teachers by their students' test scores will lead to even more narrowing of the curriculum and even more teaching to the test. This practice violates a basic rule of psychometrics, which I learned about when I served on the National Testing Board. Tests should be used only for the purpose for which they are designed. A test of fifth grade reading is a test of fifth grade reading, not a test of the teacher. Tests measure student performance and not teacher quality. A few weeks ago, I returned from a visit to Finland, which has one of the world's best school systems. Not only has Finland scored at the top of international tests for the past decade in reading, in math, and in science, but the variation in quality among its schools is the smallest of any nation tested in the international assessments. In other words, Finland has achieved something very much like equality of educational opportunity. Students in Finland never take standardized multiple choice tests until they apply to higher education. The students do take teacher-made tests. The national curriculum consists of broad guidelines assuring that every child has a full program in the arts and sciences and not detailed prescriptions that tell teachers how to teach or what to teach. Finnish teachers are all required to have 5 years preparation, including a master's degree. Admission to teacher education programs is highly competitive. Only 1 in 10 who want to teach are accepted. Teachers have, as I said, 5 years of education, and they all learn how to help all children learn, including children with disabilities and children with language needs. Teachers are highly respected professionals, and they are trusted to act as professionals. I remember in one school that I visited, when the principal was asked, what's the secret? He said, the first part of the secret is called trust. We trust our teachers. Finland has one other great advantage. Only 3 or 4% of its children live in poverty. Here, it's nearly 25%. The Finns want a great school system, and they pay for it. What a world of difference from U.S. education, where we test everything and everyone that moves because we trust no one. And the more we test, the more we can't even trust the test, because there are so many incentives to game the system, to avoid the kids who might get low scores, to teach test-taking tricks, even to cheat. Officials in Washington, D.C. and Atlanta boasted of their test score gains, but their claims have been undermined by allegations of widespread cheating. Officials in New York City boasted of the miracle of the test score gains, and that's in my city, but their boast turned hollow when an independent investigation last year revealed that the state education department had made the test easier year after year to inflate the scores, and overnight the New York City miracle collapsed. Now, I'm not suggesting that testing in itself is bad. The problem is that tests today are overemphasized and they're misused. They should be used for diagnostics to help teachers and help students. They should be used for information, not for handing out bonuses or firing people and closing schools. When high stakes are attached to test scores, people lose sight of what matters most in education, and they focus on the wrong goals. As more time is devoted to test preparation, the tests themselves lose their value as a measure, and the tests become corrupted as a measure. Bear in mind that the tests we use are not scientific instruments. They're not barometers or thermometers. They are social instruments created by humans, and they're subject to measurement error, random error, all sorts of other statistical errors, as well as poor wording and poor scoring. In my years on the National Assessment Governing Board, I frequently saw test questions struck down simply because they were worded the wrong way or the answers or questions were ambiguous. I also worry about what it will mean to the future of our nation if we have young people taking year after year after year of multiple choice standardized tests, whether we will squeeze out every last drop of creativity, innovation, critical thinking, originality, the very attributes needed for success in this century. The multiple choice approach is really associated with the beginning of the 20th century, entering the industrial era when we needed good factory workers who could follow orders. That's not what we need today, and yet our testing is designed for the early 20th century. So the corporate reform agenda, which is now the status quo in education and has been for at least the last 10 years, rests on the claim that our schools were great 50 years ago, but they have fallen into decline. Now, I want to suggest to you, because I'm a historian of education, that the reformers are wrong because they don't know their history. Three big changes occurred in the last 50 years, and they had a big impact on our public schools. First of all, the courts and the federal government ended legally mandated racial segregation, and our society continues to deal with the consequences of generations of racial discrimination and poverty. African American families continue to suffer from the legacy of segregation and the lack of economic opportunity. Secondly, our society ended the practice of excluding children with disabilities from public schools. This has been expensive and challenging. And when reformers complain about rising costs, they apparently do not know that special education has been the single biggest recipient of new funding over the past 40 years. When Congress passed the legislation for special education, it pledged to pay 40% of the cost, and it has never filled that promise. Third, because of changes in federal law, our society has experienced an enormous wave of immigration from non-English speaking countries. Many of our schools now have significant numbers of students who cannot read or speak English. So if you look back 50 years ago, back when I was graduating high school, many of our schools were racially segregated, had few, if any, students with disabilities, and had very few non-English speaking students. Our schools today have to deal with the challenges they have and not long for a time when such challenges were ignored or did not exist. As far as progress goes, we have only one national measure, and that's the National Assessment of Educational Progress, which is a federal testing program. It's been operating since the early 1970s. And contrary to the reform narrative, there has been substantial academic progress on NAEP these past four decades. Achievement has not declined. In fact, black students made the greatest gains, especially in the 1970s and 1980s. No one knows exactly why. Paul Barton of the Educational Testing Service wrote a paper about this last year, about the stalling of the achievement gap progress. He said maybe it was desegregation, maybe it was smaller class sizes, maybe it was the added resources from federal programs like Title I, and maybe it was the increased economic opportunities for black families, and maybe it was all of the above or something that he couldn't think of. The black-white achievement gap that existed in the 1970s was dramatically reduced. In some grades and in some subjects, it was cut in half. To make new progress, we may need to do more of what we were doing in the 1970s and 1980s. But what about those awful international test scores? Isn't it terrible that our students rank only in the middle? Why aren't we number one? When the latest set of international scores were released last December from a program called PISA, the Program in International Student Assessment, Secretary Duncan reacted with alarm. He said it was a wake-up call to the nation. President Obama said it was our generation's Sputnik moment. Now, what you need to know is that the first international test was given in the mid-1960s, and our students ranked 12th out of 12. We came in dead last. And over this past half century, we have usually ranked in the middle or in the bottom quartile, never at the top. Apparently, the corporate reformers don't know this. Now, last January, when the president gave his State of the Union address, he said that we shouldn't listen to the naysayers. I think he was talking about Secretary Duncan. He said, we shouldn't listen to the naysayers because our nation has the world's greatest economy, the most productive workers, the most inventors, the most patents, the most dynamic businesses, and the best colleges and universities in the world. So, one might wonder, how is it possible that a generation that ranked in the bottom quartile on those international tests produced all these wonderful achievements? Maybe those international tests don't predict the future of our economy. Now, I'm old enough to remember the real Sputnik in 1957, when the Soviet Union launched the first space satellite. And at that time, the media said we were doomed, and it was all the fault of our lousy schools. You notice they don't blame anything but the schools. They said the Soviets were going to beat us because their science and math education was better than ours. But note, they're gone, we're still here. Why? Because we believe in freedom and opportunity, in individual creativity, and in ingenuity, and not in compliance and five-year plans. We certainly need to improve our math and science programs, but we achieved our economic successes without investing billions on billions in testing and test prep. One other thing you should know about the international test. On the last one, the one that came out last December, American schools, which had less than 10% of their students in poverty, had test scores that were significantly higher than those of students in Finland, Korea, and Japan, the world leaders. Our schools, in which 25% of the children were in poverty, were tied with the world's top nations. As the level of poverty rises in the schools, the test scores fall. If we could reduce poverty, we would have higher test scores across the board. But our corporate reformers don't want to talk about poverty. They say it's just an excuse. They say that schools alone can solve the problems of social inequality. But they're wrong. They're demoralizing our educators, wreaking havoc on our schools, our teachers, our principals, our students, and our communities. Last year, the corporate reformers heavily promoted a propaganda film called Waiting for Superman. That film had a simple but by now familiar storyline. American public education is failing, the international scores are terrible, the national scores are terrible, our schools are a disgrace. We're failing because we have so many incompetent teachers who can never be fired because of their greedy unions. The film offered solutions, and the solutions it offered were privately managed charter schools, most of which have no unions, testing and accountability, merit pay, deregulation, competition, firing teachers whose students get low scores, and, of course, it asserted that poverty was not a problem and resources didn't matter since we're already spending more than enough, as the film saw it. When I saw it, my head started spinning because I had heard these same ideas for years within the conservative think tanks that I had abandoned. And that movie and various books and articles that followed all repeat the same storyline. We see it on NBC's Education Nation. We heard it from Oprah. We heard it on Time Magazine, cover of Time, cover of Newsweek, on and on. Of course, there are many problems in American education, and of course our schools must be improved. But I believe the corporate reformers have identified the wrong problems, and they offer the wrong cures. The single most reliable predictor of test scores is family income. Poverty is the problem that drags down academic performance, not bad teachers. It's the elephant in the room that the reformers don't want to talk about. The more poverty, the lower the scores. This is true on the SAT, the ACT, the National Assessment of Educational Progress, and all state scores. They all reflect first and foremost family income. This is, of course, the test scores are a reflection of differences in family literacy, family education, books in the home, access to health care, to good housing, to basic nutrition. All these things matter. If you have them, of course, maybe they don't matter, but if you don't have them, they matter a lot. They affect children's motivation and their readiness to learn. The reform movement promotes strategies that have failed again and again. But since they disregard evidence and they will not listen to critics, they continue to promote these failed ideas. Charters can be good, charters can be bad. They are not the answer to the problems of American education. There are now more than 5,000 charters enrolling well over 1.5 million students. That's about 3% of our nation's public school students. There are some excellent charter schools. There are some dreadful charter schools. On the whole, there's no difference in performance between charters and regular public schools because there are excellent public schools and there are some very bad public schools. Some charters are run by responsible organizations. Some are run by entrepreneurs who want to make money. Some are run by incompetents who shouldn't have public money or be in charge of children. Some of them get high test scores by skimming top-performing students, by excluding low-performing students, or by high rates of attrition. The studies that we have of charter schools, the most significant being one out of Stanford University, an economist there named Margaret Raymond, who is associated with the Hoover Institution. The study was funded by the very conservative Walton Family Foundation. It was anticipated that it would be cheerleading for charters, but quite to the contrary. Margaret Raymond looked at half the charter schools in the nation, almost 2,500 of them, and what she found that pairing charter schools with similar regular public schools, 17% of the charters were better than a traditional public school. 37% of the charters were worse than a traditional public school, and among 46%, there was no difference. So in 83% of the cases, the charter was either no better or worse than a regular public school. There was a study of charter middle schools and compared them to regular public middle schools. Mathematical policy research last summer, no difference in either in test scores or in behavior. Charter students have been compared to regular public school students on the national assessment since 2003. This comes out every other year, so 03, 05, 07, 09, no difference between charter students and regular public school students, whether looking at the test scores on the national assessment of African-American students, Hispanic students, urban students, or low-income students. So the next thing that comes up on the current reform agenda, for some but not all the corporate reformers, is the issue of vouchers. And vouchers for a long time seemed to be a dead issue because every time vouchers were presented for a popular referendum, they were voted down. So they're not being submitted to popular referenda anymore. Instead, they're going right to the legislature, and people who want vouchers are buying legislators. Vouchers don't work. Nonetheless, voucher programs are now being passed. Indiana just recently passed a statewide voucher program. Voucher advocates are on the move in Pennsylvania and several other states. But we now have the evidence of Milwaukee. Milwaukee is a district that's had vouchers, publicly funded vouchers, for 21 years. That's a good long run. And here's what we know about 21 years of vouchers. The claim was made that there would be a dramatic improvement in academic achievement and that competition would cause all boats to rise and the public schools would get better because they had to compete with the voucher schools for students. So now we have Milwaukee in 2009 for the first time participating in the National Assessment of Educational Progress. There are about 18 cities that have participated and that compare performance to other cities. Black students in Milwaukee perform on a par with black students in Mississippi, Alabama, Louisiana, and Georgia, meaning their test scores are amongst the lowest for black students in the country. So there was no improvement for the black students in the public schools. But then the state scores came out just this past spring, and what the state scores showed was that there was no difference in performance for low-income students in the voucher schools as compared to the public schools, meaning that performance is bad across the board, whether students are in the public schools, the charter schools, or the voucher schools. So the state of Wisconsin has poured $1 billion into the voucher experiment over 21 years, and it has lifted no boats. There has been no rising tide. But the state of Wisconsin, Governor Walker, decided that vouchers are such a great idea that the legislature is going to expand the voucher program, lift the income limit so that more people can participate in it, and extend it not just beyond, more kids in Milwaukee will be eligible. Now it's being extended to Racine, Wisconsin. But the interesting thing here is that the voucher advocates are no longer claiming that there'll be a big leap in academic achievement, because it hasn't happened in 21 years. They're just saying it'll save money. It's not about helping kids, it's about saving money. So then comes this question, well, what about this claim that the teachers' unions are the ones that are holding us back? Well, we don't have too much evidence of that, because the highest performing states in the country are Massachusetts, Connecticut, and New Jersey, all of which have very strong teachers' unions. If we look to the states that have very weak teachers' unions, they're the lowest performing states in the country. So there's not too much support there in terms of evidence. I mentioned that I'm just back from Finland, so it being one of the highest performing nations in the world consistently over the past decade, I of course ask about whether the teachers were in a union, and they said, well, yes, about 105% are. And they said, actually, the teachers and the principals belong to the same union. That doesn't seem to be a problem. So now we have this new obsession from the corporate reform side, and it's been made into obsession, I believe, largely by the Gates Foundation, and that is that our problem is teacher evaluation. If we could only evaluate more teachers, we would be able to identify those bad teachers, get rid of them, and everything would be much better, and the scores would rise. The problem is that, again, the research doesn't support this. We now have a huge body of research that says that all the methods we're currently using about who gets higher test scores and who doesn't are inaccurate and unstable. That teachers who are considered highly effective 1 year will not be highly effective the next year, depending on which test you use and depending on who ends up in their class. Students are not randomly assigned, and teachers have no control over who's in their class. So the composition of the class makes a huge difference, and 1 year the teacher may have a very engaged and willing class, and the same teacher the next year may have some troublemakers that make it difficult for the other kids to learn. These measures are not stable. So one of my colleagues at New York University, an economist named Sean Corcoran, did a study of teacher evaluation based on growth models, you know, how much test scores go up year after year, in both New York City and Houston. And what he found was these ratings were highly inaccurate. He said there's a huge margin of error, that a teacher in New York who is ranked at the 43rd percentile may actually be at the 15th percentile or could be at the 71st percentile. So you would be quite accurate if you said that this teacher was average, above average, or below average. All of these things would be true. Now, one of the things that never gets mentioned, but that concerns me, is that by using student test scores to evaluate teachers, you shift the balance of power in the classroom. The students are now given permission to fire their teacher. They can withhold effort. I think this is very problematic, particularly because we have probably gone way too far and undermining the authority of the adults in the classroom. Now, a friend of mine who's a principal and a highly rated principal who's won all kinds of awards of a large public school in New York said to me what she envisions is the litigation ahead when the state evaluation system gets into high gear and she labels these teachers effective and these teachers ineffective and all along the spectrum. She anticipates there'll be lawsuits. There will be parents who say, I will not have my child in Ms. Jones's class. She's an ineffective teacher. Who will want their child in those classes, even though the measures are inaccurate? She says that she will have lawsuits from parents saying, my Johnny didn't get into Harvard because he didn't have three effective teachers in a row. The reformers say that they want quality teachers in every classroom. But so many excellent teachers are so demoralized and are leaving the profession because of all this constant criticism of teaching. Given the current national attacks on the teaching profession, we must wonder who's going to want to teach in the future, which is why these attacks should stop. Now, many people have asked me, well, what about Teach for America? I admire the young people who joined Teach for America, and I have often said, in fact, I debated Wendy Kopp last June in Aspen, and I said, if I were a young person graduating college, I'd probably be applying to Teach for America. It sounds like a wonderful program. It's like the Peace Corps. But when young people join the Peace Corps, they're not sent off to another country to be the ambassador. And yet we take these young people in TFA, they get 5 weeks of training, and they're in front of one of the toughest classrooms in the country. And then they're gone 2 or 3 years later. This is no way to build a profession. This reliance on Teach for America as the answer has actually been very harmful to any discussion of how we improve the teaching profession. Now, another of the favorite reforms of our day is merit pay. And what you need to know about it is that it's been tried since the 1920s and it's never worked. The most recent study of merit pay was done in Nashville, Tennessee, Vanderbilt University, National Center on Performance Incentives. And the economists who designed the study said, well, the reason that merit pay has never worked in the past is that the incentives were never big enough to motivate lazy teachers. After all, if you only offer them $3,000 or $4,000 or $5,000, that doesn't move them. So they offered a bonus for higher test scores of $15,000. That's a pretty good bonus for people who are making $45,000 to $50,000, right? But at the end of 3 years, they found that there was no difference between those who were eligible for the bonus and those who were not. My guess is that the teachers in both the experimental group and the control group were teaching as hard as they knew how, and the bonus didn't make a difference. Now, we also have testimony from the great business guru, Edwards Deming, who's considered one of the people responsible for the economic renaissance in Japan years ago. He has written about performance pay in the corporation. He never said anything about education. What he said about performance pay, when you set colleagues in competition with one another for money, is that it's a very bad thing because it destroys teamwork. It destroys collaboration. It's a bad idea in business. It's also a bad idea in school. Schools are communities. They should not be people competing with one another for dollars. It's not a prudent use of dollars because it's bad for the organization. It also doesn't have results. New York City just experimented over 3 years with merit pay that went to schools. Entire schools would get a big bonus if they got the test scores up. They wasted $56 million on that one before they got an evaluation saying it made no difference. Now, last May, our most prestigious research organization in the country, the National Research Council, the National Academy of Sciences, released a 9-year study in which they concluded that tying incentives to tests doesn't work. It doesn't raise achievement, as we have seen in No Child Left Behind, where the achievement gains have been very small. And they said, more importantly, it incentivizes bad behaviors, the sort of behaviors I've been discussing tonight. It incentivizes grade inflation, cheating, and gaming the system. There's now a growing body of research showing that when you give performance bonuses, you actually reduce motivation. Oddly enough, people don't work harder. They work as long as the dollars are there. And when you take the dollars away, they lose their motivation. They don't work at all. There's the writings of Daniel Pink in his book, Drive. There's a behavioral economist named Dan Ariely, who wrote a book called Predictably Irrational, and a man named Edward Deci, a psychologist. Why We Do What We Do. And what Pink, Ariely, and Deci all say is that people work harder and better when they're motivated by idealism, by a sense of purpose, by having autonomy in their work, not by the promise of more money and a control and command structure. Yes, we do have a crisis in education today. Will we allow this reform movement to decimate public education, one of our most cherished democratic institutions? Will we permit them to transform a public good into a free market commodity? Will we lose a precious community resource and impoverish our democracy? Will we exchange our ideal of equal opportunity for the goal of a race to some unknown top? What should we do? Well, first of all, we should remind ourselves about what good education is and not accept the fail models that I've been describing. Higher test scores are not the goal of education. Some districts will get higher test scores by investing time and money in test prep, but that's not the same as good education. The kids learn the tricks of test taking. They don't learn to love learning. The goal of education is to develop well-educated citizens to sustain our democracy. That's been its goal now for well over 150 years. This means that every child should get a full and balanced education. Good education includes the arts, history, civics, foreign languages, the sciences, mathematics, and physical education. Physical education not once a week, not twice a week, but every day. The arts meaning the arts, music. Music responds to something primal in our souls. We need music, and we're losing it across this country. A good education happens when teachers are treated with respect as professionals, not controlled by petty bureaucratic mechanisms and phony targets. A good education is one that recognizes that children are not widgets, but human beings who grow and develop in different ways. We can improve our schools by strengthening the education profession. Teachers should be better educated and better prepared for the challenges of today's classrooms and today's children. We need to pay much more attention to the recruitment, the support, the development, and retention of teachers. When they tell you that teachers can't be fired, bear in mind that 50% of the people who start teaching are gone within 5 years. That is a leakage of a leakage of human talent and of people that we should not tolerate. Teaching should be a commitment to a career and not just an interesting experience. We need better instruction that uses all the technology at our command and that relies on the wisdom of skilled professionals. We need assessments that ask students to demonstrate what they've learned, not to pick one of four boxes. The achievement gap begins long before the first day of school. 1/3 of the children born to women who don't receive medical care during their pregnancy will be born with disabilities. These are preventable disabilities. We should prevent them. Every woman should have prenatal care. To narrow the achievement gap, we should provide a high-quality early childhood education. We must make sure that every child arrives in school healthy and ready to learn. School and society are not different worlds. They are intertwined. To the extent that we improve our schools, we improve our society. But we cannot improve our schools without removing the obstacles that poverty imposes on nearly 25% of our children. Only Mexico, Turkey, and Poland have more child poverty than we do. This is a national disgrace. It's incomprehensible that the richest nation in the world, with more than 400 billionaires, cannot supply a good school for every child. That's a vision worthy of our best efforts. History will judge us by what we do today to make that vision real for every child in this nation. Thank you. Thank you so much, and I'll be happy to answer your questions if I have answers.
Not many speakers get standing ovations in the humanities lecture series, so well done. Any questions? Yeah.
Hi, Diane. One thing that you didn't say much about, one of the central features of No Child Left Behind is testing the performance of children from different groups. And over the past 10 years and up to the present, civil rights groups have been very strong supporters of the accountability provisions in NCLB for that reason. There's a very large segment of the sort of civil rights movement today that sees this as a vital dimension of educational reform. Don't want to see that go away. So what would you say to that?
Here's the thing is that there are different civil rights groups, and not all civil rights groups are agreed on that. There was a very powerful statement, which I write about in the paperback edition of my book, that came out last summer, and it was signed by the NAACP, the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, the Urban League, and three other groups. And it was an objection to race at the top. And what they emphasized is needed. They didn't say anything about we need more testing, because actually the achievement gap has barely budged at all over these past 10 years. And when you think about the test, 50% are always going to be in the bottom 50%. And the bottom 50% will consistently be the same kids. I mean, there'll be some movement around, but it's going to be the kids who have strong disabilities, the kids who don't speak English, and the kids who come from poverty. But what the civil rights groups emphasized last year that they wanted most was, one, greater resources targeted to the communities that were poorest, and two, high-quality early childhood education, and three, experienced teachers. And no schools closed without the full participation of the communities and parents affected. They didn't say anything about we want more testing. I mean, there's a kind of myth that grew up around No Child Left Behind, that it's really great because now we know there is an achievement gap. There were books written about the achievement gap 5 years before No Child Left Behind was passed. So we know that there's an achievement gap, but testing doesn't close it. It just exposes it. And the response to the gap is test more, and that doesn't close it either. So it's the actions that are needed and not more testing. And again, what I said in my talk was that we should use testing for information, and we can continue to test for information. But unfortunately, there is a kind of a maniacal belief that the data is an end in itself. And I think I don't know how we get beyond that, but we have to. Because I've wondered, and I've posed this question sometimes to teachers and principals, what would you do differently if you didn't know what your children's test scores were? And I saw this in Finland, where they did the tests were teacher made, and the teachers were focused on the children in front of them, on helping them meet personal goals, and not on helping them raise test scores. So I think it's a deep philosophical divide. I've become so distrustful of the test scores, and maybe it's a kind of a personal weakness of mine, but having been immersed in the testing movement for so many years, I've come to think that it provides us with information that we should act on to help people, but instead it's become the target, and that's all wrong. I just don't trust the scores. I think
at least we're having a conversation about gaps.
We've had that, honestly.
A national conversation, not among a small group of academics.
Yeah, but it's...
That's a plus.
But we're not doing enough to close the gaps. I mean, all we're doing is saying that the gaps exist, and the gaps in some ways are even worse, because if anything, there's more segregation today than there has been for 30 years, and the most toxic combination is a concentration of poverty and racial isolation. Yes.
Hi, Dr. Ravitch. Yeah. I wanted to know what your recommendation for action is for those of us who are like actually stuck in the trenches of the classroom. How do we subvert the system while earning a paycheck, I guess? I mean, like quite practically, you know?
Uh-huh. Well, the most important thing you can do is to look at the children in front of you. They're your precious charges, and do everything you can to help them love learning. And there is something called the Bartleby Project, which is more or less an opt-out. Some people figured out that if a certain percentage of kids don't take the state test becomes invalid. I don't know whether that's true or not, but I just have a big problem with the way testing has become like the thing that ate American education. And it's not to say that the schools were great before, but that we need to be so much better, and we're moving in the wrong direction. So what you have to do as a teacher is to focus on the kids in front of you, and also bear in mind that all bad things eventually come to an end.
Thank you.
Welcome to Kansas.
Thank you.
I'm sensing that no college student left behind is already upon us, not only here in this state at this university, but at a lot of other universities as well. And so I'm struck by the fact that you were in the trenches and you changed your mind. And as you pointed out, there's a lot of people who do not believe the evidence, and how do you get them to believe the evidence? And I'm wondering if you could speak more about how you're, like, what evidence or how you changed your mind. Obviously, you believe in the evidence, but how do you change someone's mind who doesn't believe in the evidence, I guess is my main question.
Well, here's the thing was that I believed when there were what seemed like good ideas and no evidence, and as the evidence began to come in, I couldn't continue to believe in those ideas because they were being tried. I mean, like a lot of people, I thought, well, let's give vouchers a chance. Let's see what happens. Now we know what happens, which is that it doesn't help anybody because a lot of very bad schools are created by run by incompetent people. There are some good schools where kids get vouchers and they're lucky they can go there. But on the whole, it's not an improvement. And that as we create competing systems, we end up with almost a kind of a separate and unequal situation where, I know this from the New York City experience, the charter schools are favored and the regular public schools are crowded. In Detroit now, they're going to open lots of new charters, and in the public schools, there are classes with 50 children. This is wrong. So there is a, right now, but wherever these reform types are in charge, they show preferential treatment for the privately managed schools, which then have additional resources and all kinds of extra favoritism. And it never helps in a society to have multiple publicly funded systems because we just dilute our efforts. We would be much better off, I think. For instance, the charter schools are undermining Catholic schools. Catholic schools are closing because the charter schools are saying we can provide the same thing and we're free. So we see Catholic schools closing all over. I think that's a huge mistake. But I think how do you persuade people? This is what I've been doing, to just present the evidence. And the evidence is very strong. And study after study, research after research, demonstration based on experience, whether it's Arne Duncan's experience in Chicago or the Milwaukee experience with vouchers. Or, you know, there's a parent out in Oakland, California who started a website called Charter School Scandals. Dozens and dozens of stories of people ripping off the public. I mean, that's not necessarily typical of charters, but it just shows what happens when you deregulate. When you deregulate, some good things happen and some bad things happen. And a lot of people are misled. So I'm not saying that all charters are bad, but that this is a diversion. It's bringing free market thinking of deregulation will solve the problem. And it hasn't solved the problem of the economy. That's why people are occupying Wall Street right now.
All right, so I have a question about, I read a really interesting statistic a couple weeks ago saying that to cover all standards and all benchmarks, it takes somewhere around 15,000 hours to cover all those from K all the way up through 12. But teachers realistically only have about 7,000 to 9,000 hours to address all of those different standards. So how can schools or school districts go about changing the amount of information that they're supposed to present, because they're still tested on all that, but they don't have the time to cover everything? So how can we combat that?
Well, I think that, you know, what I was saying earlier about what's a good education? It's an education that where kids are taught to read and write and do mathematics, but it has to include the arts and sciences. All of this, I mean, I have to say, I was very involved in the early days of the standards movement, and the idea was not to overwhelm people with more than could be accomplished, but rather to say, you know, all kids should have the arts, and the civics are really important, and civics and history, and here's why. It's because it's about citizenship, it's about knowing our history, and so forth. But what's happened is that all of this has been turned into a mechanical operation, which has moving parts. And the standards are being written by people who don't have to implement them. The Common Core standards were developed in 18 months. They have never been implemented anywhere in the United States. No one has ever tried them. And now there are 40 or more states that have adopted them. And it's going to be this giant national experiment. And the Common Core standards might be good. They might be terrible. They might increase the achievement gap. Nobody knows because they've never been tried anywhere. So I'd say that we have... I'd like to use as a model, if possible, let's say some of our finest elite private schools, the schools that President Obama selected for his children, the Sidwell Friends School, happens to be the same school where the director of Waiting for Superman attended, or the school that some of the, like Bill Gates went to the Lakeside Academy in Seattle, Michelle Rhee went to the Maumee Valley Country Day School in Toledo. Let's look at what they do. They have small classes, they have physical education every day, they have lots of arts, they have experienced teachers, respect for teachers. They don't seem to be overburdened with all of these mandates coming from above. So I think that we have to rethink what does good education look like? And we're not thinking about that. All we're thinking about is a mechanical series of mandates, regulations, tightening the screws on public schools while loosening the screws on the charters. There's an imbalance here, and I don't think it's accidental.
Hi, Ms. Ravitch.
Yeah, hi.
Thank you for speaking. And I suppose what I have is part commentary, part question, I suppose, if you deal with that for a second. But I teach in a Kansas City, Kansas school, which is nearby, and I have our student body is 70% African-American, 20% white, about 5% Hispanic, and approximately, I believe, 85% free and reduced lunch. In a neighboring town, there's a school that has not one, I believe, two greenhouses. It's quite opulent. They've got an Olympic swimming pool. And these are the structures that are in place. And I suppose my question is, do we need something drastic done? Do we need an Occupy the Classroom movement or an Occupy the School movement? And I mean that very seriously, not just as commentary. Like, I often wonder if I could somehow spur, say, 500 of my students to drive to Overland Park, Kansas, and just camp out and refuse to leave until they get a locker room that doesn't look like a concentration camp.
The answer is yes.
Thank you.
No, I mean, I think that what we need is a burst of activism to call attention to not just the difference in test scores, but the differences in opportunity and the differences in resources. And the kids who need the most get the least. And that's wrong. So if we're serious about closing the gap and not just using this as a rhetorical weapon with which to beat up on public schools, then we would be reversing roles. I was at one meeting where I guess it was with the Durham School Board in Duke, and they were saying, this school is great, this school is not great, why don't we switch the teachers and see? But one school was a selective school, and the other school wasn't. And it wasn't the teachers that were making a difference, it was that this one had a selection mechanism and this one didn't. And, you know, maybe we should be doing a lot of different things, including Occupy the Classroom. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. I really appreciate your speech, and it's very thought-provoking. And in your speech, you have mentioned lots of times about the word motivation. And I love this word. So does the policymaker, Obama. They're using the word motivation in terms of test score and money to motivate the teacher, to motivate the student. And yeah, you know, as you have said, it's wrong. It's the wrong form of motivation. And as you have just mentioned, it's really the meaning, the purpose, the commitment that will make change in terms of the school reform or the kids' performance. So I have come up with an idea. Should we invest to set up a department in every school, that is name is a motivation department, which helps to set up models, you know, have to set up, help personal goal settings. Would that be possible?
I don't think that there should be a department of motivation. I think a whole school, the entire school, should be focused on motivation, meaning the motivation of students, and recognizing that the school must do things that motivate students. The school must have activities, it must have projects, it must have goals that are aligned with the things that students really care about. And so if you can reach the things that touch students' passion, they will be motivated. But when you say that your whole life is defined by your test score, a lot of kids are going to be so turned off. First of all, because testing is not something that they want to do. They don't come to school to be tested. And it becomes a definition of who they are. And this is a terrible thing when you stigmatize a child with a score, because there are many, many people who've succeeded in life who probably were not good test takers. I know that Michelle Obama has always said she was not a good test taker. And she said, I don't want my identity to be shaped by my scores. And I think that's a good principle. But we have to motivate teachers as well. Teachers, I think the teachers have the hardest job in America. So I think that what's needed is a different worldview, and this is what I'm trying to say. And I get into these debates all the time with people who say, then how will you measure growth? How will you measure this? How will you measure that? And, you know, how do you measure families? How do you measure your brothers and sisters and your parents? And I mean, there are certain institutions where what matters most is being engaged in something you love to do, doing it zestfully. And it's those wellsprings of idealism, of passion, and of purpose that we have to awaken in children and in teachers. And the things we're doing now stifle those very things. So we have to change our view. And I want to recommend someone that I hope you will all read. He's a Chinese-born scholar. Forgive me if I say you reminded me of him. He's at the University of Oregon, and his name is Yang Zhao, Yongzhao, two words, Yang Zhao. Yang Zhao is passionate on the subject of how we, because he's been an American now since 1992, are corrupting education through our over-reliance on measurement, and that we must educate for creativity, for joy, for purpose, for love of life, for love of learning, for all of these things. This is what matters: character, integrity, you know, civic responsibility. These are the things we care about. And having the scores, when frequently they are arrived at in ways that are meaningless, we're aiming for the wrong targets.
Forgive
Thank
me
you.
If I don't take your questions. I think we'll draw to a close.
I didn't call this line over here, though.
Well, there's quite a few there. Do you want to take them all?
I didn't. I don't have my glasses on, so I didn't look to the left.
Let's just have one more question, then, please.
Well, here in Lawrence, the top predictor of school success or failure comes down to race, comes down to the color of your skin, and even more so here, I guess, than poverty, although poverty is definitely our neck and neck number two. And so our community's involved now in a discussion of how we can best resolve this, and, you know, it's very unclear. I think we need to put smaller class sizes in the schools that need them the most, no matter what side of town those happen to be on. And other creative ways, lengthen the school day. I think we need to have the best teachers in front of the best students, and some other things along that line. Bus transportation to students who need to get there, even if they live closer than the legal minimum amount to get to.
Could I press you to get your question?
Yes, I'm sorry. So what I'd like to know is, when you said earlier, you know, well, a lot of times the poor students get the least, but what about when the poorest or at most at-risk students get the same, and the same isn't enough, and we need to go beyond the same. So now we've got to convince parts of the community that some children should get things other children aren't getting because they need them. And so I'd like your thoughts on how do we get people to understand that, because it's too emotional to just present them data, and also any thoughts you have on particulars on closing the achievement gap. Thanks.
Sure. The best way for schools to improve is to have community involvement, parental involvement, have parents engage with their children. As I said earlier, making sure that children have nutrition, the health care they need, the basic, arriving in school healthy and ready to learn. And then making sure that parents understand what's expected of them, what they need to do to be good parents, to be involved and to help their kids, read to them, read with them, listen to them read, and be involved in the school. All of these things make a difference. Collaboration and cooperation around children. If we were serious about closing the achievement gap, or narrowing the achievement gap, because as long as social conditions remain as they are, we'll never close it. But if we're serious about it, then of course we need smaller class sizes, and some children may need one-to-one tutoring. Jeffrey Canada's Harlem Children's Zone, which I have a lot of things I like about it and some things I don't, but the kids there get, of course he has $200 million in the bank, so he can do a lot of things that regular public schools can't do. But the kids get one-to-one tutoring when they need it. And I think that makes a big difference. I think that I'm not so sure about the longer school day. If there's a longer school day, it should be used for athletics and the arts.
Well, I'm sure you'll want to join me to say thank you to the speaker, Professor Ravitch.
Thank you.